All right. Hi, everyone, and welcome again to another Lunchtime Facebook Live. Unfortunately, today, Zoom would not connect to Facebook. We've been trying, I promise. We've had all our tech people in the background working hard, but it's not going to happen. So we've decided to record it and play it for you later, and you can send in your questions. And also, we're going to be having a discussion group on Thursday, August the 26th from 4:30 to 5:30, so you can bring your questions there as well. So let's start. My name is Lucy French, and I am one of the family support workers here at AFABC, and I support the Coast Fraser region. I'm also an adoptive mother of three, and I've been a foster parent for 13 years and have fostered over 40 children. So I am privileged to be coming to you from the ancestral and unceded lands of the Squamish, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Musqueam nations. I'm very happy to have Jane Ann from MCFD and Delia from Sunrise Family Services here to discuss what we're seeing in the changing trends in adoption in BC, in both the Adopt BC Kids program through MCFD and the agency adoptions. So again, before I let them introduce themselves, I'll just mention again that we are going to be hosting a post Facebook Live discussion for people like you to come and ask questions about the topic or how this topic affects your family. And I'm going to be hosting that, and it will be taking place on Thursday, August the 26th from 4:30 to 5:30. And you can register at bcadoptions.com/events. So this is a new thing we're trying out, and we'd love to do this and maybe dive a bit deeper into how this affects your family. So Delia, did you want to please introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, my name is Delia Ransbotham. I'm currently the Managing Director of Sunrise Family Services. I'm a lawyer by training, and before working for Sunrise, I worked for a firm that did a lot of child protection work with the Ministry of Children and Families. I am not adopted myself, but my father was adopted in 1930, a long time ago when things were very different in adoption. And so I got to see how not having an open adoption affected him, and how finding out that he was adopted had a significant impact on his life when he found out as an adult. But I've now been working at Sunrise since 2013 doing adoptions, and we do international and local domestic adoptions.
Great. Thank you, Dea. Jane Ann.
Hi, everyone. I'm Jane Ann Mintenko. I am an adoption social worker with the Ministry of Children and Family Development. I've been a social worker for 32 years with the ministry, and the last 28 in adoption. I am also an adoptive parent. Our son joined our family through the ministry. Our son joined our family at the age of 5 months, and he's now 18 years old. So nice to be here.
Awesome. Thanks, you guys. We really appreciate both of you being here. And I think this is such an important topic. And so let's dive right into the questions. So I'm going to start the first question to Delia, and then Jane Ann, please, you can add in any comments that you have as well. Okay. So our first question, can you tell us about the changes in adoption that you've experienced over your career? So that's a big question, but what are some of the big changes that you've seen over your time working? Oh, you're on mute, Delia.
Sorry. I started at Sunrise in 2013. That was after there had been a significant decrease in intercountry adoptions. The height of intercountry adoptions when we were seeing probably the most that were happening were in the early 2000s. You know, the numbers out of the United States, I think, are the easiest ones to grasp. In 2001, there was about 19,000 adoptions, intercountry adoptions into the United States. And by 2012, that had dropped to half, about 8,700. And that number continued to decline. In BC, we saw similar declines throughout the 2000s. So there was... when adoptions, the agency process started in BC in 1996, there was seven agencies. By the time I got on the scene in 2013, it had dropped to 4. HOPE, which was an agency in the Valley, had closed down in 2012. So the sort of height of intercountry and agency placements in BC in 2006 and 2007 were about 320. 65 or 66 of those were domestic placements, with 15 of those being direct placements, and the remainder, so 240 or so, were intercountry adoptions. So since that time, we've seen a decrease in the number. Some of that is because there's just fewer agencies. Now there's only 2 agencies, us and the Adoptive Center of BC, which is up in Kelowna. The countries that we've seen large numbers of adoptions from have changed. So China used to have a significant number of adoptions, and that's dropped off almost entirely. We used to do a large number of newborn adoptions from the United States. That's also dropped off almost entirely. And we've also seen a change in the profiles of children who are available for adoption. What we've started talking about more and more here is that really our role is finding homes for children who need homes, as opposed to helping families who want to be parents be parents. It seems like a subtle difference, but the children who are being placed from other countries are children who have significant needs, whether those are medical needs or cognitive needs, or just developmental needs. And the children are getting older because there's a significant push to find local placements for children before you can find an international placement. So the children who are being placed internationally are often older, sometimes because of process and sometimes just because they haven't been able to find homes. There's been an increase in the number of countries who've signed on to the Hague Convention on Intercountry Adoption, which has been great in the fact that it sets up good processes, but it adds red tape. It also means that the length of time it takes people to adopt is increased significantly. It used to be that people would apply, do their home study, and have an adoption from China sort of all within 6 months. And now most intercountry adoptions are taking 2 or 3 years. So we're holding onto files longer, so the costs are increasing as well. But on a possibly positive note, we're also seeing an increase in the number of relative adoptions, intercountry relative adoptions. So that's been one area where we've seen the numbers increase.
Thank you. That was really, really informative. When you said direct placement, what does that exactly mean? You said there were a majority of them, or a lot of them, were direct placement.
So in BC, there's 3 ways that you're able to adopt children in British Columbia. Jane Ann will obviously talk about the ministry adoptions. There's local agency placement. So that's when a birth parent will come to the agency wanting to do an adoption plan. And then we provide profiles of parents who've already been approved to adopt, and work with the birth mom on choosing an appropriate family and going ahead with a adoption plan. Direct placements are when a birth parent and an adoptive family come to us and say, and the birth mom, who has the right to choose with whom she wants to place her child, she will say, I know these people, these are the people I want to place my child with. If they're not related, if they're not relatives, they still have to go through a pre-placement assessment. So they still need to connect with an agency to do that placement work. So that's what a direct placement is. They're not the majority of domestic placements, but every year we see 5 or 6 of them. So,
okay.
Yep.
Great. Thank you. Jane Ann, what about you, the changes in adoption that you've experienced over your career?
Yeah, I guess one of the biggest things that came to mind is that openness and adoption was embedded in our 1996 legislation change. And, you know, at the time, BC was pretty groundbreaking in the country when it came to opening records. We were kind of the leading province in that area, which was really exciting. And I was privileged to be part of the implementation of that legislation. And so now, you know, a child can learn their birth name and birth family can learn who their child was adopted if this isn't already known. And I guess openness is part of all of our placements. Like, I can't think of any placements that we're doing that there isn't some level of openness. And, you know, children are maintaining connections to birth family members when it's in their best interest to do so. And, you know, sometimes it's just a letter and picture exchange, and other times it's ongoing visits and fully disclosed and sort of everything in between. And some kids come with quite a large number of birth family members to for adoptive family to embrace and get to know. I guess another thing that struck me was the advent of the internet and social media. Certainly changed the face of openness. You know, nowadays you can pretty much find anyone any way you want, really. It's not that difficult. So that certainly has impacted, you know, our openness registries and search registries and that kind of thing. And I think technology, that was something else that really struck me, aside from the internet and stuff, but just technology in and of itself. You know, I spend a lot of time on the computer, probably more time than I do in talking to people, you know, in person. So, I mean, when I started, and I'm going to date myself, you know, we didn't even have computers. There was no computers. We never mind cell phones and all the different applications that we're now required to be part of. So that's been, you know, that can be a bit of a learning curve for sure. You know, just an example is matches between families and children were done by people, real people, up until 2003. I think my own adoption was probably one of the last adoptions that had been done through our adoption services in Victoria. And after that, our adoption management system came into place. And so we have a computer system that now starts the generation of matches. There's lots more that we do afterwards. So those were sort of some of the big things, aside from the changes. And I know we're going to talk a little bit more about the reasons that we're seeing the decline. Obviously, that's happening as well, and we'll talk about that. So,
okay. All right. So, Jane Ann, I'll start with you on this one. So what are some of the social reasons that factor into fewer or different types of adoptions taking place, such as infant adopt? Well, I mean, I'll let Delia speak to that, but the MCFD, Adopt BC Kids program.
Okay, I guess the one thing that strikes me first, of course, is that the shame and secrecy that, you know, was attached to an unplanned pregnancy is, you know, is way less now, and it's not existent, but it's way less, and that families are supporting young moms and dads to raise their children. So, and then I thinking about, it's not really a social reason, but for the ministry, there's many more options for children not to come into care, which has decreased the pool of available children. So we have, that's a huge change, actually. There's several out of care options for children. And we have family finding programs where we're doing a way better job of finding families for kids so that they don't have to come into care. And those have been really successful. So that all has played into the pool of children who are legally free for adoption continues to decrease. And then I would be remiss to not mention reconciliation, the federal Indigenous legislation, and nations taking over their own child welfare, you know, means fewer children being placed for adoption, and many nations are not supporting adoption. And unfortunately, we still have an overrepresentation of Indigenous children in foster care, and not a lot of adoptive families of Indigenous heritage to meet those kids' needs. So those are the ones that I came to mind.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Thank you. Delia, did you want to speak to that? What you've some social reasons that might factor into the fewer and different types of adoption?
Sure, definitely. The with intercountry adoptions, the Hague, when it was brought into force and as it's been adopted by many countries, there's requirements within the Hague that they try to find local placements before finding intercountry placements. It's really stabilized the adoption process in many countries and has led to an increase in an acceptance of adoptions in a lot of countries. So we're seeing the number of domestic adoptions increase significantly, which I think is wonderful. Because of that, the children that are being placed internationally are ones that cannot be placed locally. So there are children that have complex family backgrounds or more risks or more needs in their backgrounds. I think we're seeing a decrease in birth rates around the world, you know, even before COVID and what COVID's done to everything. But, you know, women are waiting longer to have children. They have more opportunities. The availability of birth control is increasing. And even locally, we're seeing, you know, the effects of having good, you know, sex and health education in schools and just declining unplanned pregnancy rates. The other thing that I think is interesting is that a lot of children who previously in intercountry adoptions may have been reported as being sort of quote unquote healthy children or children without any needs. I think a lot of that was because of a lack of awareness of the effects of trauma and developmental stages. And so children who previously may have been identified as not having any needs, now we realize that even being in an institution for 2 or 3 years, there's going to be some delays, there's going to be traumas. And so I think we are just much more aware of the challenges that intercountry adoptions, for example, or older child adoptions are going to have. And so in that aspect, some of the children who are being adopted have the same profiles as they did 10 or 15 years ago. It's just now we and the countries of origin are much more aware of the needs of the children.
Mm. And probably just even in general, how adoption, you know, because we've had more research into how adult adoptees feel and what they've gone through, right? And just when I speak about J&M, we were talking about openness, like there's just all of that we didn't know so much about in adoptions previous.
Definitely. And I think with intercountry adoptions and some local adoptions, if they were interracial adoptions, people were under the assumption of, well, they're going to be part of our family and we're going to include them in our family, not realizing how important it was to acknowledge the child's ethnic background and their cultures and to have a sense of pride in those cultures. And so there's a lot more emphasis on cultural plans and language, the importance of language. And, you know, it's no longer, oh, well, we're going to get, you know, Vietnamese food once a month sort of thing, right? Right. Now we have families who learn languages, who join organizations, who give back to countries on a level that we weren't seeing before.
Yeah. Great. Awesome. Okay. So Delia, I'll start you off here. So as a result of these social factors that we've just been talking about, what does infant and intercountry adoption, and you've kind of spoken to this, but maybe what is it sort of looking like right now, sort of numbers of adoption completed each year? You've spoken a bit, but a little bit, maybe a bit more about the complex needs. What are you sort of seeing right now?
Sure. So we, with our infant adoptions, we're seeing an increase in the number of birth parents that we're working with and children that have risk factors, higher risk factors than we might have seen before. I think some of that has to do with options that are given to birth parents now. Like whereas some of the children would previously have been taken into care, now there's an opportunity for birth parents who may have substance abuse issues or mental health issues to consider doing placement plans. And so we're seeing for our local programs, children that just have more risk factors, whether that's prenatal exposure or, like I said, mental health issues. You know, everything is sort of being turned on its head with COVID-19. You know, we've had months and months and months of people being quarantined and not being able to be out in social situations. And so I think that the unplanned pregnancies we're seeing are even more within marginalized communities than we were seeing previously. The birth rates have been dropping in the United States and here, I think in large part because of COVID. Whether we're going to, you know, people think that there might be a baby boom if and when we all go back to normal, but I don't know if that's going to happen. But so that's the local placements that we're seeing. Internationally, Sunrise's numbers of local placements have been relatively consistent for years, at around sort of 20 placements and then 5 or 6 direct placements every year. We have seen a slight increase in our domestic placements because of the other agencies that have closed down, but overall the numbers across the province have been declining slightly. Internationally, what we're seeing is that it's just taking much longer to get international placements. And so families really need to be in it for the long haul. It's going to take 3 or 4 years before a child comes home in a number of situations. I think it's good that we have a better understanding of trauma and how that impacts the children. Like, families are getting much better educated on understanding about meeting needs of children instead of just trying to modify their behaviors. And so I think we're seeing stronger attachments because the parents are working on that attachment. It's no longer the thought that a kid's going to come in and they're going to love, everyone's going to love each other and it's going to work. Yeah. Parents are putting in the time and effort to get the training to create the attachments that children need to deal with the traumas. Mm-hmm. The medical issues are very similar to the ones we've been seeing for years. So if families are open to, medical needs like children that are HIV positive or children that have heart conditions or orthopedic issues, there's always a need for those parents. And BC Children's Hospital is amazing. And so families who are open to adopting children with medical needs can get those needs met, but the families will often tell you it's not the, like, as challenging it is to watch your child go through medical treatments, those aren't the challenges. The challenges are helping the children with identity and trauma and those unseen issues. So families are often afraid of what they see as special needs, but the reality is the special needs, the medical needs, are often the least challenging things that people need to deal with.
That makes a lot of sense. Jane Ann, did you want to speak to sort of, what is it looking like for the Adopt BC Kids program right now?
Sure. I'll talk more specifically about this, the types of needs the kids have, in the next question, but just overall, I just went into our adoption management system and looked at stats for the last fiscal year. So just to put some numbers, so from April 1st of 2020 to March 31st of 2021, we are seeing a total of 157 children placed in the province through our program. To break that down just a little bit for people, about 34% of that were foster to adopt. So those are children who've been in foster care. Many of them would have been in the same foster home for many years, and the attempts to reunite them with family or other options are not available, and a foster parent is open to adopting the child. And so for consistency of care for the child, that happens. General adoptions are about 35%, and then child-specific adoptions are about 25%. And I would say we're seeing quite an increase in that. So kids are coming onto our caseloads for guardianship where there's already an identified plan. So aunties available to adopt, or grandma in Ontario is interested in adopting, or those kinds of things. And so then of course we're having to and needing to explore those options for children. And so that happens about 25% of the time. So it's fairly big piece of the work that we're doing now. Age ranges, probably the biggest age range is 2 to 5, but I say that with the caveat that often those kids have older siblings. So we have, you know, sibling groups of, 6 to 11 year olds, and we still have about, a percentage of kids who are being placed who are over the age of 12 as well. So, so just generally children are older and part of sibling groups, and they have moderate to significant needs, which I will talk about. The other thing that Delia was just talking about that made me resonated with me too was because of the agencies, or I'm theorizing that because we're down to two agencies, we're seeing families who may have looked at an intercountry adoption previously coming to us. So we're seeing a large percentage, I'm just talking about my own office, so this isn't a provincial perspective, but of non-Caucasian applicants coming to our coming to our program, which is fantastic. However, we do place children, culturally. And so, I have to tell people that, we don't have a lot of, say, South Asian children in care, and we're unlikely to place a Caucasian child into a non-Caucasian home because we have lots of Caucasian applicants. And so I'm just seeing that fairly recently over the last few years, that's coming as a challenge. So that's sort of my note on that. Thanks.
Thank you. Oh, shoot. There was something you said I wanted to jump on, but that's okay. It'll probably come back. great. Okay. So the next question, and I'll put this to Jane-Ann, and I think you had sort of already, you're thinking about this. What are some common misconceptions that you hear from, what are some common misconceptions that you hear from parents who are considering adoption?
Sorry, I thought we were going to, what do adoptive parents need to know about the children?
Oh, you know what? I have them in out of order, but we can totally do that. Let's do that. No, let's do that one. Okay. What do prospective parents need to know?
Okay. Sorry, Lucy.
No, don't be sorry. It's all good. We can skip to that one. That's great. Okay. And we can go back to the other one. So what do prospective adoptive parents need to know about the children that are eligible for adoption in BC?
Okay, so my thoughts that came to mind were that first we can't look into a crystal ball and anticipate the needs of the children will be and what services they will need. So there's always lots of unknowns. And of course, with the younger the child, the greater potentially the unknowns as they grow. And that children come with multiple needs. It's not just one need, it's often several needs. I would say the majority, if not all, of the children that we're planning for are exposed prenatally to alcohol and drugs. And with the advent of, the drug scene and fentanyl, you know, we're seeing a lot of children who are exposed to fentanyl. And the research is pretty new on obviously there's no long-term research on what the long-term impacts of that drug is. So that's a big question mark for people, right? So many children are being diagnosed on the autism spectrum. I think about like 10, 15 years ago, ADHD seemed to be the diagnosis. And now there's a huge percentage of our kids on the autism spectrum. Children who previously or would still potentially fit the definition of low needs or low risk can end up being quite complex as they grow. And so I think that's really important for families to know that little baby that you're holding could end up having, you know, a lot of challenges over the years as you grow. The other thing that we're seeing too is a lot of children who are struggling with gender and identity issues, children who are transitioning while in foster care or after they're adopted. It's just a couple of general points. I guess parenting through adoption is not for the faint of heart and can be more challenging than ever anticipated. Parents need to educate themselves. They need to network. They need to take courses. The learning has to continue, and to have experiences with children with special needs is huge. to be able to bring, take those skills into parenting. And that, I guess the biggest thing, one of the biggest things for me is having a strong support system that will offer practical support, like respite, having a break, taking the child out or taking the child on a holiday so the parents can have a break. So, and just having that support system is really, really critical. So,
yeah, I think for parenting in general, but then you add the extra layer
Absolutely.
Yeah, and then you add the extra layers, though. And I think one of the things, and Delia spoke to this, maybe you did too, but trauma-informed, right? Getting that trauma-informed parenting piece is huge.
Yeah.
I think I remembered what it was. So you mentioned the age group, and I wanted to just go back to that, circle back to that a little bit, because you said, I think, 2 to 5, with the caveat of the siblings. And the reason I want to circle back is because one of the things we often say is the Adopt BC Kids program, we're like, there's really not children. We say 5 and up.
Yeah.
And so would you say that that's a true number for sort of individual kids? Like, I guess I'm just trying to get more clarification on that.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I think it is. And I mean, I can just, you know, I did a sort of a look at our kids who are waiting right now, and just kind of looked at 0 to 6 year olds, just single children. And there's, you know, a handful of them, maybe 7 or 8, but all of them are showing with, you know, pretty significant challenges, you know, cerebral palsy, mobility issues, autism, those kinds of things. And then if I look at siblings in that range, it's pretty minimal as well. So I would say that I didn't do 6 to 11, sorry, I should have, but it'd be interesting to sort of look and stuff. But yeah, I would say that I think it's accurate for you guys to be providing information to families that it's, you know, it's really 5 and up. Those 2 to 5 year olds are usually part of a sibling group. So,
and they're part of it. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Or they're kids with really significant need.
Okay. Right. And I think we add to, that's really helpful. Thank you for clarifying that. So Delia, did you want to speak to the, what do prospective parents need to know about the needs of the children? Is there anything you want to add, or do you feel like we've fleshed that out?
I just wanted to reinforce the fact that, you know, all children, even if they don't have a diagnosis, kids coming from other countries, especially if they've been in orphanages, which is what mostly we see. We do see some countries that have foster care, but mostly they've been in orphanages. So although their basic needs have been met, they're not getting the stimulation that they're getting here. So we see delays, and people have to be prepared for those delays. I think some families are quite shocked when they pick their children up and compare them to children in BC who've had parents who've been sitting, like, sort of hovering over top of them and like talking to them and trying to stimulate them all the time. But it is amazing to see a child go from getting their basic needs met to being in a family where two parents are paying attention to them and just watching them shoot up, both physically, like we see a physical manifestation of direct one-on-one care, but we also see like a huge increase in gross motor skills and fine motor skills and like developmental stages. But it means that families have to put in that time. And, you know, we have some families who say, oh, well, I want to adopt a child who's 5 or 6 because they can go to school. But it's really important for families to take that first year to focus on the needs of the child and focus on building attachment and focus on making the child feel secure. With the children that we're seeing now, the focus really needs to be on what the children need. The focus needs to be on, like, we need families who are coming in because they have the time and the space and the desire to help a child that doesn't have a family. And with people who've gone through the education and gone through different programs, it's amazing to watch how they can see a child whose behaviors might otherwise be seen as deviant or inappropriate, and understand why those children are having those behaviors, and go underneath them and meet the child's needs, and then watch the behaviors dissipate. And I think it's that sort of intellectual side of parenting that can be really, really rewarding. Like, it's hard and it's a grind, but it's amazing when you see it happen. So I think adoptive parents have to know that it's hard. It's really hard at the beginning. And having that support system that Jane Ann talked about, especially other people who've been through it, who can say, oh yeah, nope. This is, you know, we went through it too, and we're out the other side of it, and it's gonna be hard, but you can come out the other side of it, right? I think that's really helpful. You know, when I spoke about the medical issues before, I think it's important for families to realize that adopted children from overseas qualify for MSP. And there's no barriers to them getting treatment for any medical need that they have. So that's, I think, helps people sort of turn their minds to possibly adopting a child who has needs.
I think that is so awesome. And I think two of the words that stuck out was time and space, right? So, and I think that idea that when we adopt children into our lives, we have to have that time and that space and realistic expectations of how much time and space and that group, that the support group is going to be so important. And I go back to the trauma-informed parenting. That's where a lot of this is going to come up, for ways to what's underneath the behavior. Such important stuff. All right, so that the question that we sort of skipped over, but I feel again that we've kind of spoken about it a little bit, but what are some of the common misconceptions that you hear from parents who are considering adoption? Jane Ann, do you want to speak to that for your program?
Yeah, I think that a misconception is that even the children placed as infants can have attachment issues and trauma. So, you know, we're seeing kids who are, you know, little when they were adopted, but there was either prenatal trauma or early trauma in their lives. And that can have really huge, huge impacts as they grow. Another misconception, love is not enough. Adopting or that they're going to save a child. And we need to have an understanding that children those are really good things. That's really important. But the children have been through loss and have a variety of issues and challenges that we've talked about today on this session. And many have unresolved trauma. I think expectations, Lucy, you were talking about it, Delia, people have to have realistic expectations of kids. If you go into it thinking it's going to take 6 months for a child to attach to you, and it's going to take, and it actually takes 5 years, then it's really going to be a tough go. So, or just expectations that, you know, my child's going to go to university or my child's going to do this. And so I think that that's really important for families to have realistic expectations, or in some cases, maybe no expectations, depending on the profile of the child. Adoptive parents don't get to choose the child they wish to adopt, or when, you know, they're not next in line, they get the next available child. That's not the way it works. And both the agencies and us as the ministry, our job is to find the best family for a waiting child, and not the opposite. So I appreciate you bringing that up earlier, Delia. And that even if you're open to a child of another culture, I spoke to this a bit, we for the most part are placing children in culturally compatible homes. I guess the other one that's coming up is that having gone through our hub screening process and the AEP online, people are coming to our files are coming to our office, and people are thinking that, okay, the next step is a home study. And that's not necessarily the case. What we have 30 waiting families in our office right now, and more come in every week. And what we're having to do is do interviews with families and then prioritize the families that are willing to consider moderate to significant needs, and unfortunately give the message that other other families are going to wait and either files are closed or we ask them to go away and do a whole bunch of stuff to educate themselves more about our waiting children. So those were a few that came to mind for me.
Those are really important. Thank you, Jana. Delia, what about you? What are some misconceptions you've seen or are seeing?
I think one of the misconceptions is that international or intercountry adoptions won't have any openness. Like a lot of people say, oh, I want to do an intercountry adoption because openness makes me uncomfortable. We're seeing more and more openness in intercountry adoptions with like Amnesty or Ancestry.com and all of those where you can do those DNA tests. It's becoming easier to find people. Social media as well makes it easier to find people. And people who have done, who've adopted internationally, in part because they didn't want openness, have to struggle when their children are 9 or 10 or 11 and are going through the, you know, the section at school where everyone's talking about where they come from and, like, you know, doing family trees and all that sort of stuff. Their kids have questions and they want to know and they can't answer the questions. And so although at the beginning they thought it was going to be great that they weren't going to have to deal with this messy openness, it leads to heartache for the children. And this empty hole that the kids can't fill and the parents can't fill for them. And so we have a lot of families who are coming back to us, like, desperate to try to find information on children that had been left at orphanages. And we just don't have that information. And so I think parents need to be more, I think it all comes down a lot for me, for parents really have to be child focused. Like, they have to think about how this is going to impact the child. And there's stuff we can do to help around questions around openness, but intercountry adoptions are no longer closed adoptions. I think the opposite of the idea that children under 2 won't have attachment issues, which we hear all the time, is that for some reason children over 2 can't attach, and they're going to have significantly worse attachment issues than children under 2. Which again isn't true. Some children are more resilient, some have had different trauma, and a lot of it comes down to the work that the parents are gonna put in. Also a misconception that it's the children who have to attach to the parents, and adoptions don't work when kids don't attach to parents. Adoptions don't work when parents don't attach to kids. That's the challenges that we see. I think parents, especially parents who are adopting because they've had challenges with fertility issues and they're not able to parent, they think that they're going to see their child and fall madly in love at the beginning. And even people who have biological children will tell you that that doesn't always happen. And it's okay. Like, you don't know these kids, you don't know who they are. And you have to give yourself a chance to get to know them and give yourself a chance to attach to the child. And it's okay to say, you know what, I don't think I like this kid right now. And it's like, of course you don't. You don't know them and they're kicking you and they're punching you or they're doing whatever. So those are the sort of misconceptions that we see. Also, I think people coming to adoption for reasons that aren't based on the child that they're adopting. Like, I really want to have a sibling for my child. I think those are problematic reasons for adopting. And I think the biggest one, which we've spoken a little about, is the misconception that they want a child who's healthy and what the definition of healthy is. Confusing risk factors with actual needs is a challenge. I often ask parents to think about writing up a child proposal for themselves based on their family's mental health issues, or, you know, those of us in our 40s and 50s, a lot of our moms smoked when they were pregnant and stuff like that, right? And so think about what their child proposal would look like, and realize that, you know, risk factors are different than needs, but they have to be comfortable with those risk factors. Mm-hmm. Or is that sort of a broad overview?
So good. And I think I just, something that I heard that I just wanted to reiterate was the sibling one. And I do get that a lot, that people are wanting to bring another child in for a sibling for their child that, you know, the child that they have right now. And I think that's lovely. And, but it goes, it moves away from that idea of child focused for that new child that's coming in, that the reason you're adopting that child is for them, right? For that child. And that child focus, you're focusing. So I just think that, I don't know if you want to speak any more to that, but I just think that's really an important message to remember. So thank you. I don't know, I think we kind of covered this, but maybe Jane Ann, I'll just get you to end on this. We get a lot of calls for, and you've spoken to this, Delia, low risk or healthy infants or toddlers available through the Adopt BC Kids program, MCFD. I don't know if we've maybe spoken enough to that, but I just maybe want to end on that. Would you say that there are any?
Yeah, I would say no. I mean, I see that. I would say every child that is being planned for has some, you know, risks or needs that are going to be, that wouldn't put them in that, the word healthy. So I would say the answer is no. It doesn't mean that their needs can't be met, but it's just really important to have an understanding that those kids just don't exist.
Thank you. So anything else you guys want to say or add before we say goodbye?
Well, thanks for the opportunity to do this. This has been great.
Yeah,
I agree. It's interesting to hear about the opportunities in the ministry. I know that, you know, we often have families who come and say they're open to adopting a child over five, with the thought that an inter-country adoption is less complicated than a ministry adoption. And we often refer them back to the ministry because, you know, you're going to get good records. You're going to have like language, you're going to get support from the ministry. And so there's kids in care here who need families, and families who are open to that. I think it's good for them to explore both options because we don't know what's going to work best for them.
Awesome.
Yeah. Great. Wonderful. Well, thank you so much to the both of you for volunteering your time to come on and do this. And I feel like this is going to be such an important resource. So thank you very much. So to wrap up, I also wanted to thank all of you for, well, I guess you wouldn't be viewing right now, but whoever views this, for tuning in. Also, if you have any more questions, you are always welcome to reach out to our family support team. And we are going to be, as I said, doing the post Facebook Live discussion group on Thursday, August the 26th from 4:30 to 5:30. You do need to pre-register, but it's not difficult. You can just go on to bcadoption.com/events. And we'd love to see you there and to talk a little bit more about this. We also have our next FASD parenting group, which happens every second month. This one will be coming up on September 14th. Again, it does involve pre-registration. And we have our waiting parents group on October 18th. That's every second month, sort of they alternate. So again, FASD September 14th and our waiting parents on October 18th. So you're welcome to come to any of those or all of those. And I'll just wrap it up and say goodbye and say thank you again to the two of you, and everybody have a wonderful rest of your Wednesday. Thanks.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.